steel workers that got me elected back in 1972 as a U.S. Senator. And Denny Flora, by the way, a teacher and a ball player, a husband and dad, who really took a big jump. He actually did an ad for me, making me famous. I want to thank him, and Denny, thank you and your whole family for your help. You know, excuse me, I've been told there are a lot of iron workers here. Got some iron workers here? All right. Well, look, folks, the iron workers, steel workers, they built this town, the beautiful bridges, they made Pittsburgh famous. And a lot of folks around here were hurt badly when the steel factories closed. I come from a little town after we moved down from Scranton, the coal guy, to a town called Claymont, Delaware. We used to have 4,500 steel workers, iron workers, steel workers, and it was there's none there now. And but that's what I was raised with, watching people bust their neck to make a good salary, and all of a sudden, all gone. But you know what? A lot of folks around here have been hurt when the steel factories closed. President Trump made a lot of hay out of that 4 years ago. He came and said, look, I get why some people, he said, take a chance on me. And I understand why some people did take a chance, because the fact of the matter is he said that he was going to make sure that he took care of you all. You know, he had his chance though. Now we know exactly who Donald Trump is, who he cares about, how he governs. We saw it last night, and it's all about him. He didn't speak to you all in that debate. He spoke about him. He didn't talk about the concerns of the American people one single time. President Conway and I were talking on the way here about Donald Trump's trail of broken promises and lies all across the industrial Midwest. He's done nothing to really hurt anybody except the working class folks. That's what he's hurt. Matter of fact, he hasn't done anything to help working families. You look the other way. While more companies have closed their factories and shipped jobs overseas, President Trump said he ran for office because he was concerned about the forgotten man. Well, as soon as he got elected, got inaugurated, he forgot the forgotten man. The truth is, I don't think he ever respected us in the first place. Behind closed doors, we reported, he called some of his own supporters, quote, disgusting. They're not in the same class of economic standing. He looks down his nose on working families. They're just trying to do the right thing, just trying to make it. They pay their taxes, play by the rules. He thinks that folks who sign up put their lives on the line for our country. It's been reported by multiple major outlets. Our veterans, our service members. He says they're a bunch of suckers and losers. It's despicable. I'll tell you right now, not how I was raised in Scranton, Claymont. Not how any of you were raised around here. It's not our, you talk like that, my mother would say, you get your mouth washed out with soap in our household. Not a joke. The fact of the matter is, it's not how any of us were raised. Donald Trump can only see the world from Park Avenue. He cares only about the super rich and the well-connected thing. You take a look at what he's done. Unlike Trump, I don't measure America's success based on the stock market. Because growing up, I didn't know anybody. Because I don't own any stock. I guess I have stock based on my retirement, but I don't even know what it is. I don't own any stock. People I grew up with didn't own any stock. We measure our success, where I come from, based on what families talk about at the kitchen table when they get up in the morning. At night, after the kids, you clear the plates, and after mom and dad sit down and talk about, are we going to be able to get four new tires on that car? I know the tires are bald. But you have to wait another month, honey, before we can buy them. We can't do it now. They're conversations ordinary people have. What about that new hot water heater? We can't do it right now. We're not in a position to do it. Who's going to tell her? She can't go back to community college because we just don't have the money this year. They're the conversations. The kind of conversations took place in my house. There's a conversation taking place all over the United States of America today. But you wouldn't have any idea it was based on listening to Trump. Families like the one I grew up with, the ones I saw every day I took the train home. I made over 2,100,000 miles on Amtrak over a total of 40 years, traveling back and forth 250 miles a day, every day the Senate was in session. And you know what? I'm not kidding. I used to look out the window, like I did on the way down here. Look out the window, look into the homes. Homes like I was raised in, a three-bedroom, four-floor house, nice house. Four kids, grandpa moves. Well, I look out that window, I'm wondering, what's going on tonight in that house? What are they thinking about? What do they mean? After we have debate on taxes, on economic policy, in the Senate, listen to what people say. Well, you know what? They're the folks that, in fact, matter. You know, I can remember one night in our house, asking my mom next morning, my dad seemed so restless. The walls were basically paper thin in the house that we lived in. And she said, it's okay, honey. I said, what's the matter with Dad? She said, well, we just lost our husband's children. But it's going to be okay. It's going to work out. Folks, you know what? For me, health insurance is personal. I guarantee I'm going to protect your, you have, thank God, your private health insurance and your unions. A lot of people don't have it. 10 million people have already lost their health insurance because of a lost job and the things have gone out of business. And now he's going to go to court right after the election is over, trying to do away with the Affordable Care Act, costing literally over 100 million people out of pre-existing conditions, not able to charge more. You're a woman, you're going to be able to be charged more again just because you're a woman for the same service that man is receiving. If you're a pregnant woman that becomes a pre-existing condition, so much is at stake. So much is at stake here. I can remember thinking to myself when I got elected to the Senate, right after that, I was down in Washington before I got sworn in, and I got a phone call from my first responder in my fire company, saying exactly what I was broadside of my wife and daughter, and killed my wife, killed my daughter. And it took about 2.5 to 3 hours to get my sons out from the jaws of life because they were trapped in the car. And I remember thinking, after the fact, what in God's name would I have done had I not had health insurance? Take care of them and all the answer to everything that followed. And then, when our son Bo came home from Iraq after spending years in the United States Major, in the United States military, volunteering to go, and diagnosed with terminal cancer, stage 4 glioblastoma, and lying there in bed those last months we spent with his family, his wife, the old baby, his brother, his sister, I couldn't imagine what it would be like, what it used to be before the Affordable Care Act. When the public comes in and say, you've outlined your coverage, suffer the last 3 or 4 months in peace on your own. I promise you, if I'm elected, I will protect your health care like I protect my own family. It's that basic to me. And folks, you know, the fact is that I plan to build our country and our economy back better than it was before. As I said, I focused on the folks I grew up with. None of them are asking for anything special. Just the right chance. No handout. Just an opportunity. The American public, given half a chance, has never, ever, ever, ever let the country down. Not one single time. Here's what I'm going to make sure, this I promise you. I promise you. American government spends $600 billion a year letting federal contracts, American income, build ships, to staircases, to automobile fleets, thanks to the whole gamble. I'm going to make sure that every single contract let by the federal government
has to be led to someone who makes it all in America. All in America. The entire supply chain. Not a joke. Not a joke. All made in America. And we're going to be able to do that in a way that's never been done before. When I'm president, the fact of the matter is, I'm going to end President Trump's tax giveaways. The cook is an outsourced job. Just since he got elected, instead of offering incentives to companies to send jobs abroad, which he's done, I'm going to change it, penalize companies that send jobs abroad, and give companies a tax break, a 10% tax break for them bringing jobs back home. We finally get control of this pandemic. It stole more than 205,000 lives and climbing. 205,000 lives is estimated. Unless we change something quickly, between now and the end of the year, there'll be another 200,000 Americans dead. If that occurs, the loss of 400,000 lives in America in 1 year is more than all the lives lost in World War II in 4 years. It is absolutely a travesty. And by the way, as his director of CDC said, just put on the mask that you all have. You can save 100,000 of those lives between now and then. Folks, look, your businesses are being closed, your schools aren't back to normal. Donald Trump hasn't done his job. He hasn't pulled Congress together to get a real compromise, to get something done. The House has already appropriated the money. Already appropriated money to help businesses stay open, to open schools safely, to be able to allow them. Guess what? Initially, FEMA decided they were going to make the supply masks as well as additional for both teachers and students and school openings. The president said, no, don't do that. It's not a national emergency. We shouldn't spend money on that. Folks, the fact is that not only are we going to guarantee your health care, we're going to lower health care costs. There's not an opportunity to encourage them. All you got to do is make sure that we change the law that says that Medicare can negotiate prices for all health care products, all prescription drugs. That would lower prices dramatically. I mean, my proposal was, they pointed out, would save the American taxpayers a lot of money. Really make sure that you not only have the care you had before in terms of the Affordable Care Act, but we're going to lower prices for drugs by close to 60%. Any new drug coming on the market is going to have to go before a board of 25 leading experts on medicine, set the price for that drug at the outset, that you make a significant profit, but you can't gouge people, and once the price is set, you can't raise that price at all other than the price of medical inflation. We'll save the American people hundreds of billions of dollars over time, as well as allow people to be able to no longer have to make a choice between the different prescription or they're going to buy more food. And by the way, the way we pay for all of this is we're going to get rid of his tax cuts. You realize in the middle of the pandemic, billionaires in America are richer than they've ever been. They've made over $300 million more than before the pandemic started. How about you all? You got all that kind of grip? And he's got another $30 billion tax cut to lower the capital gains rate for the people, the billionaires and millionaires. About time we start to reward work, not just wealth. If you know what I'm talking about, the major folks on Wall Street are not that crazy about me point out that I would be able to create, with my economic plan, I'd be able to create 7 million more jobs in 4 years than his plan would create, and I'd increase the total growth of the economy by $1 trillion more than he would. Because you know what he hadn't figured out? When you all do well, the country does well. You do well, money is spent, people are employed, wages rise, and everybody does better off. Well, look, the fact is that as I said, this election about Park Avenue, the
versus Scranton, Park Avenue versus Pittsburgh. I promise you, I give you my word, I will never, never break. I always tell you the truth. And when I'm wrong, I'll say so. But I'll take responsibility for what I've done. You notice he takes no responsibility. Not my fault. Governors or blue states or ridiculous assertions he made. And by the way, I'll never forget where I came from. I'll end where I began. Wall Street, the CEO of Good Girls America. Ordinary, hard-working people, middle class built America. And unions built the middle class. So thank you, thank you, thank you. God bless you all. And we're going to take this home. We're going to change this country. Take it back. God love you all. Thank you.